So we're in Melbourne with my good friend Ziad, and we're at his salon, which is actually unisex, but we'll let him off for one time only. He's basically going to talk to us about barbering not being an accredited course here, and tell us what the barbering scene is like in Melbourne. I worked with him in a barbershop in London for 2 years, so I know him pretty well. So it's really good to say.
Cool. So Ziad, you've been in Melbourne for a long time and working in the hair industry for a very long time, and you've seen the boom of barbershops across Melbourne. Can you tell us what you think of that sort of boom?
I think it's a great thing. There needs to be more support for the boom. There's a lot of barbershops opening up, but there's not really an accredited course for people that want to just do barbering. There is for hairdressing, but there's not just for barbering. And let's face it, not everyone wants to do women's hair. There's a massive market, there's a massive gap in the market for people that want to do just barbering only. And there's just no support for it. There's a lot of barbershops opening up that do specialise in men's sort of work. There's some that can do cutthroats really well, and there's others that can't. I've been to most of them in Melbourne. I've got a fascination with barbershops and men's barbering in general. So it's just something I've always been into and always liked doing. So normally when I do want to go get my hair cut, I'll go and check out a new barbershop that's opened up and see what they're like and test them out and, you know, push the boundaries with them. And there's lots of them that, you know, can cut hair really, really well. But when it comes to the traditional, you know, techniques with the cutthroat, there's not so many that are fantastic, and we need that sort of support here in Australia.
Like, do you know why the courses aren't accredited? Or?
It all kind of started, it was the late 80s. We used to have a barber accredited course here. You know, it was a completely separate industry to ladies hairdressing. There was the ladies course and there was the men's course. And what was happening back in the late 80s, there was a lot of female hairdressers that were doing men's cuts in the salon, and they were getting fined from it. So a lot of the bigger salons back in the late 80s put a lot of pressure on the men's barbering board to combine the course into one. So there wasn't barbering or ladies hairdressing, it was unisex. So the Australian barbering course pretty much came to an end in the late 80s. And slowly, you know, as the years went on, more and more bits of the traditional barbering course was slowly cut out of the unisex course to eventually being nothing in there. I mean, there's bits of hairdressing in there, but you don't get to learn how to do your traditional sort of cutthroating anymore. I mean, hopefully next year they've made a change to that, seeing the revolution of Australian barbering and what's been happening. You know, there needs to be a change made. But I think we're a long way off, to be honest, to get a proper government accredited course where you can just do an apprenticeship in barbering instead of doing an apprenticeship in hairdressing.
And what do you think the steps are to going forward to getting that course, and how do you think other people, as well as hairdressers and barbers, can pitch in?
I think we need a lot of support from both industries. A lot of the barbers I've spoken to and been to see, you know, have shut me down and basically said, well, we're not hairdressers, we're barbers, it's a completely separate industry. But hey, we've got to face facts, it's not a separate industry. We are the same industry right now. Barbering in Australia is booming, and there needs to be support for it, because there's so many kids out there that want to get involved in barbering, not just hairdressing.
So Ziad's decided to turn around the interview on me, and he's going to ask me a few questions.
What are your thoughts on Australian barbering, and how would you go about getting a government accredited course here?
I think coming from the UK, it's totally different. We've always had the barber courses, always had, you know, support. Even though like barbershops died out in the 70s and or whatever, 60s with long hair, it's still been around, and a lot of the shops have still survived. I think getting them courses into like traditional like colleges, I don't know if they exist here, but that's how I learned, and like on a 1 year course, scrapping all the short courses, because 8 weeks, 9 weeks, 12 weeks, you can't learn barbering. And just working together, I think, like you said, And now in the UK, we've got the British Barber Association. So they're starting to get a lot of support for getting the licensing for barbers. So I think as the industry goes together, it could happen. But I think, like you say, it's a long way off unless you've got the support from the higher authorities or a larger company who are going to really put the work in.
Push it.
Yeah.
True.
But awesome. Up to now, Australian barbering is booming. I'm very impressed.
Absolutely. Loving what I'm seeing around, so it's good.
Yeah. Thanks for the interview.
My pleasure. Thanks for coming down. It's been a pleasure.
When the Beatles came in Australia, the industry of the barber, which there were lots around, barber, there were good barbers, everybody tried to earn their living. So because the Beatles, they were so popular in Australia, when they come, they just love, the people love their style. So in other words, what they've done, and that's when everything had changed with the barber shop. That destroyed us. As a matter of fact, the area I started my hairdressing, I had within the 3-4 kilometers, I had 15 shops within the 3 kilometers. Every one of them, because the long hair closed down. Thank God I exist. I adapt to the long hair. I couldn't do color, I couldn't do perm, but I could have cut a longer hair. And the people just hate us in the sense, oh, barber shop, short back inside. Nah, don't go there. Don't go, that's what happened.
So Dad, in those days, to get people's confidence to come back into the barber shop, got this hairdressing sign made up. And put hairdresser instead of barber, you know.
Yes.
So I think that's pretty, you know, unbelievable, you know, because it must have been that tough.
What's
the
tough?
Beatles brought that mod style long hair back and no one had trust for the barber anymore.
Cool. So Tony, can you give us a little bit about your background as a barber?
Yeah, I started working in my uncle's barbershop when I was 13. Just sweeping the floor and cleaning up, and it's never really something I thought I would do. And then as I got older, I went through art school and did kind of was a bit of loose head. And I'd always worked in my barbershop, in my uncle's barbershop, and he kind of bullied me into doing it. So I started when I was 18, and that's like 32 years ago now, and just constantly been barbering and cutting hair ever since.
And so barbering came first and then hairdressing second?
Yeah, definitely barbering came first. My aunt was a hairdresser and my uncle was a barber, and they had a setup really similar to this. You know, the barbershop was out the front and then her little hairdressing salon was out the back. So I kind of always had both, you know, in my ear. But barbering was always my first love, and I used to spend hours as a kid just watching him like cut hair and thinking it was just amazing, watching the hair fly everywhere. And his scissors, he used to use hand clippers. Like, he refused to use electric clippers for so many years, and it was even into the 80s and he's still like using hand clippers. He had these forearms that were like this, you know. As a kid, it was like amazing to watch. And then I stumbled into hairdressing because barbering was really difficult at the time. Like, barbershops were shutting left, right and centre. His was one of the only ones left in London really at that time. And hairdressing seemed like the more likely direction for me to take. And I went and worked for Sassoons for 10 years. And then all the time I was working for Sassoons, I would work in my uncle's barbershop on the weekends and just hone in those skills. And now that, like, 90% of the work I do is in the barbershop. Yeah, I love it. It's, you know, you never get bored with it. I don't think it's anything more beautiful than a really beautifully cut traditional men's haircut. Like, just the look of the taper and just the way the haircut kind of flows, it's a pretty remarkable thing, really. That, you know, you can do it, you know what I'm talking about.
do you think it's like, it's really essential for people to have the foundations of traditional barbering?
Oh my God, yeah. There's like barbershops opening up on every corner in Sydney at the moment, and nobody really understands what a barbershop is. You know, they're if you think about it logically, barbershops died out in the 70s because of people like Sassoon's and, you know, a lot of the other big hairdressers. Guys that could afford a good haircut abandoned the barbershop and started going into hairdressers because they wanted what their girls were getting. So all we were left with as barbers was the cheap end of the market. And unfortunately, that's what people think barbering is. They look at barbering and go, oh yeah, it's a quick $10 haircut. But it should be so much more than that. It's a whole service, it's a lifestyle. It's actually, if you think about barbering in a traditional way, it was a luxury. You know, guys used to go and get their nails done and get their shave. They'd spend half a day in there, and it was a luxury thing. And I think it's unfair that we've got left with the $10 haircut market. I'm trying to move away from that and say, let's just make it more of a luxury product again.
And I mean, for the future, like, of Australian barbering in a sense, how important do you think it is that we actually get an accredited course for barbering?
Definitely.
Here?
Yeah, I'm working quite closely with Ausdare and American Crew at the moment. We're trying to get an accredited course, barbering course, where you don't have to do hairdressing as well. I think it's important to do both. I think everybody should have a grounding in both. I certainly don't have a problem with female barbers, or, you know, there's that whole anti-girl thing in the barbershop. I hate that. Like, girls have been going into the barbershop since the 20s to get their hair cut. It was just a place where you got shortcuts rather than a men's thing. And that, I'm into that. But I do think that there should be an accreditation. At the moment, there's so many people opening shops in Sydney, literally going from cutting in their mate's bedroom, never been trained, and they're opening a barbershop and they're getting away with it. It's against the law, but they're getting away with it.
Can you explain to us, like, how much you love being a barber?
Oh God, that's a never-ending question, really. I mean, obviously, there's days you come to work and you hate it. We all have those days, and there's customers and there's haircuts that you do that you're not maybe as proud of as some others. But I couldn't think of doing anything else. I've tried to do other things. I've tried to break away from it and do. I know I was an illustrator for a while. I'm falling apart. I'm like 50 now. I've got a bad back. I've got arthritis. My hands are stuffed. My neck's screwed. But there's no way I'm stopping. I love it. It's in my heart. I love it.